and welcome to the Rosies, your favourite feminist panel show.
Today on the show, we've got Jane Postlethwaite. She's a comedian and she'll be talking to us about women in comedy and answering the age-old question, can women actually be funny?
Who knows? But unfortunately, Rebecca will not be joining us today as she has other comedy-related business to attend to in London.
See how it is.
Rude.
Whatever.
We're missing our own comedian. Harsh, harsh world. Now, I'm Jessica Calgan-Hayes.
I'm Kitty Underhill.
And I'm Annie Wilby.
And you can tweet along with the show by following us on Twitter at TheRosiesTV. Or if you've got a topic for the show that you think we should cover, you can send us an email, latestrosies@gmail.com. Also fan mail. We accept that. Jane, welcome to the Rosies. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
So today we're talking all about women in comedy. Can you tell us a bit about how you got started in the comedy scene?
Well, I've always loved comedy since I was a little girl. And then I was doing, at sixth form, I did art and I did theatre. Mm-hmm. But I never really had the confidence to follow up the theatre. So I did art, an art degree. And then I got to 28 and thought, what have I done with my life? What would I like to do? And I realised I'd really like to do acting. So I did a two-year acting diploma. A few years ago, I did that for 2 years on top of a full-time job. Wow. And realised I absolutely loved it. I'd found my people. I felt like I was doing my dream. And I really enjoyed doing the comedy acting parts. So playing like a comedic part in a play, I really felt at home. Mm. Anyway, that finished. And I really wanted to do some creative writing. So I found the company Funny Women. Mm-hmm. And Funny Women are an organisation that help women get into comedy and provide like a safe space to express ideas. Great. And things like that. So part of that course was to do kind of 3 or 5 minute stand-up, which I'd never done before. Ooh. I just thought it was really, really scary. Anyway, I got up with, you know, my notes and told a story and everyone was laughing. And the lady, Lynn Parker, is the founder of Funny Women, she was running the course and she said, come back tonight. This is at Leicester Square Theatre in London. Come back tonight, we're doing a gig. Do your first 5 minutes.
Gosh.
So it was one of them movies.
Put you right up there on stage.
Yeah. One of them movie moments where you're like, I need to do this, because if I don't do this, I will never do it.
Yeah, true that.
And that day, everything kind of aligned and I went on stage and there was Aisling B, have you heard of her? She's an Irish comedian. She was on the bill. Yeah. Lucy Beaumont, another Northern comedian, she was on the bill. And they kind of put me on second. And I just did it. And then I realised I didn't have an ending. So that kind of got me interested. And then I started reading books about stand-up and comedy and writing comedy. I started watching a lot of live comedy, making notes, what was good about it, what was bad about it. And then over the last couple of years, I kind of dabbled in bits. And Funny Women do a night in Brighton as well, so they got me on to do their nights. Oh. And I played around with stand-up. And last year in January, I decided to do 6 months of doing stand-up gigs. So you get 5 minutes together and you just go to gig to gig, gig to gig. And I did that around Brighton and Hove, just to get my confidence up. So sometimes there'd be two people in the audience, other times there'd be 90.
And very different reception every time.
Yeah, I can imagine.
People are ready for you and something like that.
Yeah, and so, and then that led on to me doing some comedy plays in the Brighton Fringe last year, so 2014. Mm-hmm. And once again, I was doing the comedy characters and I really enjoyed them. And I thought I'd like to meet in the middle somewhere between stand-up, because I didn't really want to be a stand-up, but I wanted to do comedy. And I liked the freedom of writing my own material. Mm. So I decided I was going to write comedy characters. So this year for The Fringe, I wrote my own one-woman show with 5 different characters. And as well, I was kind of a bit fed up, because I'm Northern, I'm from the Lake District in Cumbria, and I was a bit fed up of people portraying Northern people as a bit thick and stupid.
Yeah.
And especially women as thick and stupid.
Oh, always.
So I tried to write my characters to be quite strong, intelligent, quite dark. And I always write what I would want to laugh at as well.
Yeah.
I suppose this sort of northern accent is a go-to accent for any comedian who's looking to make a kind of dumb person character.
It gets a laugh because it sounds, it's got a nice kind of rhythm to it, and northern accents do get a laugh because they're just a bit different. So yeah, I did that. I did the Brighton Fringe, and then I've been taking my characters out to different comedy nights, and I entered Funny Women competition, the awards. I've done them previously the last 2 years and only got to semi-finals, and this year I was like, I need to get to the finals, and I did. Yes. And it was brilliant. Yeah, I was really excited, and it was on my birthday as well.
Even better.
So that was like a dream come true, and Benefit Cosmetics sponsor it all now. Yeah. So we got made over and our hair done.
And, oh, how nice.
And it was a gorgeous theatre in London, King's Place, and it's 400 people. With a balcony, that's like the biggest venue I've done. But my confidence has just grown the last year by doing my own thing and writing what I want to write.
But you mentioned Funny Women, helping women to get into comedy. Yeah. But have you had any, I mean, it's a very male-dominated field. Yeah. Have you had any issues with that?
I think when I started doing stand-up, I was a bit timid. And everyone says, oh, it's really hard for a woman in comedy. I mean, I didn't go out and do the London stand-up nights. Which is a different kind of kettle of fish. Brighton is very friendly, and there is a lot of men on the circuit, but I found staying in my comfort zone really helped me.
Yeah.
But of course, like when you watch TV, it's usually male comedians, and I've only had a couple of times at competitions where there's been more males, and they're a bit kind of, who are you, what are you doing? But I've only had that a couple of times, and that was when I was first started out, and I wonder if that was because I was nervous, because people say, well, the men, you know, the men are going to be a bit funny, and it's competitive. And
but it is definitely a male dominated, because we can see from panel shows and television that are largely male, but now the BBC has said that there has to be one woman. Yay.
Oh, yeah. Sandy, Sandy is taking over from Stephen Fry from QI. I love Stephen Fry. I think he's absolutely amazing. But I remember one episode of QI when there were three women on it. Yeah. And obviously it's Stephen Fry, Alan Davies, and then three guests. And it was three women for the first time ever. And it was a complete fluke. But that got a joke. Like, that got a laugh on the show. It was so unusual. Yeah. And
it's kind of terrible that we're making jokes about representation, and that, wow, aren't we lucky that we have more than one woman on a TV program? You know,
like it's it should be normal, shouldn't it?
Absolutely, we shouldn't even have to comment on it.
Yeah.
And it's the same with other funny TV shows that you want to get a joke out of, like Have I Got News for You? Or you know.
I think as well with films and things like that, the lead roles could easily be female. This is why we need to change TV and film. That the scripts they write, the main characters as men. If you swap that over, it'd be so interesting. I know a group of actors in America reread the American Pie scripts and they role reversed it.
Ooh, interesting.
I think it's online somewhere, and it was supposed to, it made it funnier even, it gave it a different energy. I was watching, have you seen the film The Heat with Sandra Bullock? Yeah. That would normally be
two blokes.
It's a buddy comedy, but with two women.
But it's hilarious because it's two women and they do the most awful jokes and like teasing the men, and it's brilliant, isn't it? It's
funny seeing it the other way around.
Yeah.
I think the great thing about that film in particular is that it doesn't use the fact it's two women as shock value comedy.
Yeah, like that's
it's not, there's a woman doing something she doesn't normally do, therefore it's hilarious.
And Sandra Bullock is gorgeous, but they treat her if she's not, which is really funny as well.
Characteristics are important.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, girls. We're going to go for our word of the day now, but join us after the break.
Heteronormativity is the belief that all people fall into two distinct genders with assigned roles that are seen as natural. Sexuality, gender identity, and gender roles are seen to be decided by biological sex at birth. In this view, heterosexuality is the only sexual orientation. The term was popularised in 1991 in one of the first major works of queer theory. Its use as a concept is to reveal the expectations, demands and constraints produced when heterosexuality is taken as normative within a society. Critics of heteronormative attitudes argue that they're oppressive, stigmatising and marginalised forms of sexuality and gender, seen as deviant. This includes lesbian, gay, bisexual, intersex, transgender people, as well as racial minorities, but also affects heterosexuals, who are expected to conform to a certain role. Men, for example, are meant to provide for the family and assume as stepping outside of the norm if they take time away from work to care for children. Mainstream society uses heteronormativity to create a sexual hierarchy that grades sexual practices from morally good to bad sex. Only reproductive monogamous heterosexuals whose gender identity and performance aligns with the gender they were prescribed at birth can ever be seen as good. Everyone else is bad. Brilliant. That was our Rosie of the Week. Thank you very much, Annie, for that. We're still joined by comedian Jane, who's going to tell us a little bit more. We're going to have a discussion about women in comedy and the idea, this kind of cultural idea, that women can't be funny. Is this something you come across a lot? Do you find it, maybe it's harder for critics to accept female comedians?
Growing up, I never heard that women couldn't be funny, and I don't know whether that's a northern thing, because up north the kind of banter is a day-to-day thing and taking the mick out of each other. It's only in the last couple of years that I've kind of heard that, women are not funny at stand-up and things. And, it's a tough one, isn't it?
I think having grown up in the South, that's very much
it's quite
a cultural
prominent
thing
found,
that we deal with.
So you have it that the people say to you, women are not funny?
Yeah. I remember being in school and it definitely the girls who were funny, who had been very funny before the age of 12, the girls who are willing to be like the class clown, who'd make everyone laugh, do something a bit silly, make a fart noise.
Of course,
you're in
classic
primary school.
Yeah.
So it's fart noise, obviously, that gets the most laughs.
Yes.
As soon as they hit puberty, suddenly it's like, oh no, gotta dampen that down. Can't be funny, can't be loud, gotta just be really quiet and really like.
I guess girls that are funnier in school are the girls that don't fit the heteronormative mould. They're sort of, they're not as girly.
Yeah.
To think of the stereotype, not so girly, a bit more tomboyish maybe.
Yeah. Or if you're funny, it's sort of more of a like you're one of the lads kind of thing.
Yeah, about
there's a lot of dysfunctional comedians out there and they've become funny because they've had to be a certain way. I mean, I was very skinny at school and very tall, so I think I would be funny to distract from that, maybe.
Yeah, sure.
Definitely to look at, still am. But yeah, I think to win over people, because I felt a bit awkward. And it wasn't until I was like 15, 16 that I realized there were supermodels, and I was like, oh, they've got legs like me, and it's not. Because you just get teased about being skinny.
Yeah, being a bit awkward.
And obviously it works with bigger ladies as well. Yeah, like they get teased.
Media trope of
so they have to be funny to fit in. It's a social thing. It's like how we bond would be through laughter, and it breaks the tension. And it
definitely.
Yeah.
Well, we went to see a comedian. We went to see Louisa.
It's Louisa O'Malley.
Oh, and she was amazing.
She's great,
she was so good. But she was talking about how, at the end of the show, she was talking about how she's fundraising, or had been fundraising. I think she's raised all the money now to fund her own TV programme her as the host and female panellists and stuff like that. And she took it to a board. Mm. Or was it in New York?
She was trying to like make it happen, basically.
And the big bosses at the TV studio were like, well, without a load of men on there,
no one's interested.
Yeah,
no one's gonna watch.
Yeah, it was funny.
But and then it, like her appearance was brought into it as well, like because she doesn't sort of fit into it. You know, she's not one of those skinny, big boobed, blonde kind of comedians, but she's also not the kind of the funny fat girl trope either. She's somewhere in between. And they were she sort of said that they felt that there wasn't anything they could do with her, which is ridiculous because it means that women are having to fit into this very kind of fixed idea of what a funny woman can be when all kinds of women are funny.
And she's very, very normal looking. She's a normal size. She's a normal woman.
And if anything, more relatable.
So it just shows that a normal woman can't be funny.
Why does a woman's appearance have to be where their comedy comes from?
Yeah.
I was watching a comedy show the other night that had four comedians, two men and two women. Three of them were overweight, both the women and one of the men. One of the men? One of the men.
Yes.
There we go. both of the women reference their size. A lot of their comedy derived from, like, here's a joke about my weight, here's a joke about how it's difficult to date because of my weight. And everyone laughed. It's like, oh, yeah, that's quite good. Yeah, yeah, of course. Mm. The man who's overweight didn't once mention it. It had nothing to do with his comedy at all.
Mm. Yeah.
And the audience weren't expecting him to come up and say something. Whereas the women almost felt like they had to reference it. Yeah. They had to say, yes, I know.
In stand-up,
it's like, I know I'm overweight, you don't have to tell me.
I guess it's so that they make fun of themselves
before someone else gets
the joke.
Because a lot of stand-up, if you read books on stand-up or do courses, I haven't done a course, I've learned it myself, but they tell you to comment on yourself because it's that first 3-second impression that people get of you. So if you, and that's the tension, like, so if you break that tension and say, I know what you're thinking, I look like a so-and-so combined with a so-and-so, and everyone laughs, it kind of gets it out the way. Mm. But yeah, the women, it's very interesting how they do that in stand-up. They'll comment and make a joke if they're bigger. I'm quite uncomfortable with that because I think, why do you need to do that?
Yeah, like, well, why do you have to talk to me about that?
Yeah.
Why does that have to be your thing? Tell me your funny observations about life.
And when I first started doing stand-up as well, because I didn't really know what I was doing. No one knows what they're doing when they start out. So I'm 6 foot and I'm blonde as well. And I was very aware of being stereotyped as 6 foot blonde. So I used to, like, down-dress, didn't wear makeup and do my stand-up because I didn't want to be judged. But then I realised, you get judged no matter what.
Yeah.
And then as soon as I started having my hair nice and wearing makeup, I was more confident and I was me, and my comedy actually got better.
Mm.
And a few people have said, oh, when you first started, I thought, oh, she likes herself a bit too much or something. But when they got to know me, they realised I was a nice person.
They thought that when you weren't wearing makeup?
No, when I was wearing the red lipstick, like, oh, she really cares about what she looks like. That was, a couple of girls said that to me, which is quite interesting. Other comedians.
Yeah.
And then when they got to know me, they realised, I don't care. Yeah. But but for me to start out, I was like, who am I to wear a pretty dress? Who am I to wear my hair and makeup like this? And then at the end of the day, who are you not to do that?
Yeah, of course.
We're all, like, everyone, just show who you are.
We are, as women, very much judged on how we look.
Yeah.
Whether it's by other women, by men, by women who claim that they would not judge based on looks. I remember in university going to a feminist society.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're doing feminist stuff. and feeling really uncomfortable because it was made so clear that I did not fit in.
Yeah.
That
well, women
kind of
can,
like,
be harsh.
Mm, I see you in that big fancy dress with your hair. No, this isn't the place for you. Pretty sure feminism says we can wear what
all
we like.
Women should be involved rather than just those who, well, anyway, that's another story, isn't it?
Women can be the harshest critics, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
On a day-to-day basis, whatever career you're doing.
Depends very much whether we fit that mould of what a woman is supposed to look like.
Absolutely.
Then it's wrong. If we don't fit that, then it's also wrong.
Mm.
We're judged so much on our looks and not on what we have to say, whereas male comedians can just talk about whatever and not have to reference that, not have to mention.
Yeah. I think women are often more the brunt of the joke as well, maybe.
Definitely.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, you've got the whole issue of kind of rape jokes, rehypnal jokes. Last year this year at the Funny Women Heat, there was a lot of new comedians and there was about 3 in a row who did the rehypnal joke.
Oh,
it's like, we've heard it, all right? It's not funny anymore, just leave it. And you've always got the debate on rape jokes, should they be allowed, should they not?
Mm.
I'm not comfortable with it. I think you can be intelligent with your comedy and make people laugh.
Yeah, you don't need to make someone a victim in that.
Yeah.
Like, I think people don't realise with stuff like rape jokes, rehypnal jokes, they don't realise the kind of effect that can have on other people. I mean, you know, if you're in a group, there's a ridiculous statistic, you know, because it happens to an unfortunate amount of women. And I mean, if you do tell a rape joke to a big crowd, chances are a good couple of those women may actually be rape victims. And imagine how they feel having their trauma made into a joke. I just think it's absolutely disgusting.
And a large percentage, even if they haven't been raped themselves, will know someone who has.
Well, exactly.
If you're making that joke and you can come back and say, well, actually, my sister was raped, my mother was raped, my cousin was raped, my best friend was raped.
Yeah.
It's just, it's not funny.
No.
Especially coming from women as well. I feel really comfortable with that.
Stop hurting us. Like.
It's normalising rape culture in general.
Absolutely.
By making a joke out of it and making a laugh out of it. And it's also said that sort of every time that a person says that joke, there'll be a woman that decides that she can't trust that person anymore.
Yeah. Mm.
Because of that joke. So, you know, you go on making them if you want, but this is real feedback.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not funny.
Well, no. Thank you. I think that's a brilliant note to end it on today. Thank you so much, Jane, for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Nice to meet you all.
Harriet Tubman fought vigorously for her own freedom, and once she got it, she never forgot about those that had been left behind. So while we are still in October and Black History Month, please take a moment to remember the unbelievably brave and fabulously fierce Harriet Tubman. She successfully rescued thousands of slaves in total. A bounty of $40,000 was put on her head, but she was never captured. Her motto was, "Give me liberty or give me death," and she was nicknamed Moses by those she rescued, referencing the successful exodus from slavery. After the Civil War, Tubman served as a nurse caring for injured and starving blacks. At this time, she became the ringleader of a network of Union spies who aimed to free slaves and recruit them to the Union Army. Tubman was also the first woman to lead an armed assault in the Civil War. After the war, she moved to New York and continued to help former slaves, despite living in poverty herself. Tubman believed in equality for all, whether black, white, male or female, which led her to sympathise with the women's rights movement. Tubman began touring and giving speeches about her experiences, speaking in favour of equality, civil rights and women's suffrage. She died in 1913 in the home she established for the poor and the elderly, the Harriet Tubman Home for the Aged, which is now a historic monument.